The following content is provided under a Creative Commons license. Your support will help MIT OpenCourseWare continue to offer high-quality educational resources for free. To make a donation or to view additional materials from hundreds of MIT courses, visit MIT OpenCourseWare at ocw.mit.edu.
Tonight we're very, very proud to present Regina Maria Wood. Regina is an outstanding She studied art education, art history, and the history of Middle Ages at Ludwig Maximilian University in Munich, Germany. She is the founding editor of the magazine Regina and the creator of the label Monument. Regina Muller is visiting professor for the fall term 2006 at MIT's Visual Arts program. She situates her works in the border realm of art, fashion, and comics. She takes various formats of contemporary cultural communication and reflects on their identity-forming, economic, and functional connotations. For example, in her magazine Regina, with which she has reached a broad readership since the late 1990s, she adapts the language of women's magazines. Through subtle shifts, she underlines the common constructions of female identity. Parallel to this, she has designed clothing, carpets, furniture, and inner decor under her own label, The Monument, since 1993. And it's with great pleasure that we welcome her here tonight.
Two kinds of characters. One character was a crazy cat, found by the punk artist George Herrmann in the early 20s, and which was published in the Sunday Sundays by as a William Randall Hearst as a poem. So George Herrmann looked at it, he wrote a trilogy, and it was Crazy Cat, Ignat's Mouse, and Officer Puck, which was a dog. And this theology worked reverse. So this means that Crazy Cat was always trying to save Ignat's Mouse, because the Crazy Cat was in love with Ignat's Mouse. And Officer Puck, the dog, was in love with Crazy Cat. But the pet always Crazy Cat and Ignat's Mouse. Because Ignat's Mouse was always looking for a brickstone to throw it against the head of Crazy Cat. And then Crazy Cat, and suddenly Crazy Cat didn't wake up, he would get thrown a brick against his head. Crazy Cat was worried about Ignat's Mouse and was looking for Ignat's Mouse. But actually Ignat's Mouse was then sent in prison, the officer Pop, because he always tried to protect Crazy Cat. But the whole story is kind of like deeper, it's placed in a very surrealistic set drawing called Cocopina County. And actually, he became very famous also with this kind of language he was using. It was like very much sound language, referring to the news when he was published. And he was published in a daily newspaper also on Young Sundays. But the main editors, chief editors of this papers, didn't like George Herrmann's Crazy Cat cartoons. They always wanted to throw him out. And William Randall Hearst was a fan of him, so what he did, and this I thought was really interesting, what he did, he took George Herrmann's comic strip out of the funnies and placed them in the Ali Lasher section. So suddenly you had a comic strip in the kind of high culture sequences and not in the funnies. And so he survived this is like from 1914 around 1914. So this is one reference I did with my comic soon. Or comics very soon, that it was referring to George Herrmann's Ignat's Mouse. And the other one was an anti-detective novel, which was written by Rex Stout, and this novel is called Never Wolf. I'm not sure if you're familiar with him. And Never Wolf is kind of fictional detective. This is kind of famous New York detective star who solves his cases only in dialogues with his assistant called Archie Goodwin. So Archie Goodwin is actually the one who was running around in the city and making all the research. This guy, Neville Wood, doesn't want to move at all. He gets better and better. And he's sitting behind his table and has stripped office hours. Doesn't want to have all those cases on. So he doesn't take all of those cases on. But this detective novel is really interesting how he solves cases. So in a direct relationship between Archie Goodwin and Neville Wood. And at this time, I was doing this comic strip soon. I was living in New York City and I was working as an assistant for an artist. So I replaced myself to Mary Wood as the winner, I replaced Archie Goodwin in soon. And what we did, as what the first story was in my comic strip, was that the artwork from Sherry Lean, she did as a panel, Crazy Panel, which you see here on top. And we got a phone call, an anonymous phone call from a museum that suddenly Crazy Cat disappeared. So, and we should look for Crazy Cat as this detective office. And so what is happening here is that I used all these kind of artworks in his office, and all these artworks became kind of a tool to show how Crazy Cat disappeared. So we have here the woman of the Crazy Cat panel, and I have Carl André, who was under the rim. The ring was multiplying the Ignat's Mouse. And then you have the Kanguri machine. And so Ignat's Mouse is coming up to the Kanguri machine and throws a brick, a car, and a brick against Crazy Cat's Mouse. So it becomes a Richard Archer. So that's the case. So now we have to solve it. How did it happen? And this was the ongoing story through kind of, I think, four or five text sequence issues. But it was also about an investigation. But those messages for Kunst issues only came out every 3 months. So comics were usually about speed, about narration speed, quickness, which I couldn't hold at all. So I was starting to become anti-narrative and anti-speed. And when I What happened was, I don't show you all the panels, I just, this is, for example, the next issue which came out and the book was done first of all. So I was referring back to this man Wood and I said, looking for Crazy Cat that ran through all the papers about secret agents, diplomacy by Noam Chomsky, and looking for Crazy Cat still. So it was a whole ongoing situation through the Texas Supreme Court coming soon. And it became absolutely riot somehow, as if the people couldn't really hold off any narrative. And then, at one point, can you see some panels? This was the first book was done. And you see two pages that were really laid out next to each other in the text, of course. Magazine. So what I did then, I told myself that I'm going to stop now, that I'm going to stop soon. And what I did, I made myself visible. So instead of using my name, Bettina Möller, and soon, I wrote down about the passion from New York, I put down the visible woman. And I had an interview with myself about soon. So what soon was, what did we investigate constantly? So which crime did we investigate? The crime is actually to produce soon. So when I started, produce soon was the crime I investigated. And in this moment, when I did this interview, I decided also to step out of those art magazine pages and become myself an artist. So I made myself visible as an artist. And I started, as a background coming from this comedy that I started with my first magazine, Medina. This is the cover. And I don't have this one with me because it's really, it's out of print. But I have here other copies. I have a look while I'm talking, so I think it's here. But I needed all that piece. So this is what I started in 1994, and it has my name, Medina, and I'm also always on the cover. And the Medina magazine is an adaptation of Roma. The women fashion magazines, as we had them in Germany and started off in the 60s and 70s, and they were called the Gipfel or Petra. And they gave those magazines the first name because of this, as Brigitte and Petra were a very common name in the 60s in Germany. And so they tried to address these names as women very directly as a friend. So you talk, Petra talks to you, or Brigitte talks to you. So I thought of this and said, okay, I'm Medina, but I'm not your best friend. I don't give you tips, I don't give you advices, and I don't include any kind of fashionable, glamorous things. So still, I'm on the cover, and while I'm constantly on the cover, it's because this already should signal that I'm Asian. So it's not always like about the newest trendy models. And it is also, I have never any accessories on the cover. So it should be a bit timeless from the cover. And I also want to signal with it that behind this magazine is a real person. It's not like lots of departments which usually magazine production. There's one person, but with a team. But I'm the absolute responsible one for everything, and at the same time also to solve problems constantly. So and each magazine also has a subject. So also when I start with it, it has one subject which is not necessarily mentioned in the magazine. So it's like it's just how you can read like a red thread through. So it's like really built up page by page. And even so you have different essays, different writing styles. But I focus always that I don't lose myself completely. I raise my subject. And this one was when I started off in 1994. It was the introduction. And reproduction from various sides. One, like the terminology where women are still subsumed under this. The other one is I included essays which I reproduced as I reprinted them in the magazine, which were sometimes old, and I asked for the copyrights and I re-edited them. And another way reproduction in terms of photography. This is also a series of works of mine. You see here one page out in the first issue of the magazine, which is was in Germany, I produced it in Stuttgart. Eltern is translated. translated parents, Lebanese parents. And this typeface is exactly like the typeface from Belgium, which is also a magazine in Germany. And I as an editor, this magazine used to be my agency when I was smaller, so I was working as a child novelist. And at the same time, they also published me a lot. And this page is an interview I did with my mother, I published it first in Inamon. And it is about all those, it's about this time that I was working as this kind of advertising model. And here you see, for example, it's a reproduction became a full series of mine. As an artist, but what I did, I grew up in life size. All those ads I was working for as a child. And they're all accompanied with interview ads with my parents. And this was a very interesting advertisement. I mean, you might not know him. He's called Roy Black, and he used to be a famous singer in Germany, and played also movies, but really small, Heimat movies, no movies, like really awful ones. But he was really big in Germany, and this kind of advertisement was for a high-fi company called Rüde Offenbach. And what they did a brochure, and it was really smart, so he was the main character. And he was shown once as a teenager. So he showed like a certain gaping glass or whatever, and then he had to be like a little, as a, like a father, like a parent, he was with me, so he was still playing a father. Then he became like the grandfather, and like still one generation older. So it was like four series that they introduced with him for this type of product. So he was the main character, was a brochure, and then so the equipment, right? So another discussion was produced one. And this is, it looks also so strange because this is a photo as a reproduced and blown up out from a candy bar to the, from Haribo. So it was the, as we have Haribo then. And I was modeling there for the candy bar that's like this. And also it was for TV, advertising for TV. And yeah, having woman female phone that I see, so I had always the same for the TV. And this is for example for a catalog who sells toys. Yeah. So that was basically what reproduction of the series was, as I said, it was more of a show. And after the first issue of the Gina, I mean, it was really like, it's a small print run, 1,000 copies, and it was a very small readership in the beginning. But still, I got good response, and then I decided to continue. So Regina is published actually in context, and institutions asked me to either take part in to have a show, either a solo show or sometimes those group exhibitions. And in the meantime, they asked the director to produce the Gina. So I produced it always in the context of an institution. And this is the second issue which came out in Munich, where I was invited for a solo exhibition at the Kunstverein. And so there it was possible to produce fully for the exhibition, but also the Gina magazine. And the subject was, as the exhibition was also called, My Job Hasn't Been Invented Yet. So I was addressing in this exhibition the conditions of artists' buildings and artists, what it means to be an artist. So, which, how do people talk about actually? How you build the way? How, as a, but you do lots of jobs actually. I mean, you work as your own secretary, you work as your manager, also when you have the artist. You work in lots of different disciplines. And so I was addressing this kind of chapter in this exhibition, which I don't show you slides now. And at the same time, I produced the Gina magazine, which was also had this kind of subject, but also addressing professional women. So I was speaking about actually against the stereotypical frame of women jobs, rather that we create a new space in this way of jobs and how we try to organize, as I think also in working conditions. And back to comics. I have here this is a letter of Gregory. So most of you might have known that. She's published on Fact and Graphics, and I published their interview, Umstein did with her, and she has this character, Bitchy Bitch, as I love her. And Bitchy Bitch is a secretary, so she makes her money as a secretary, but she hates her job, but she doesn't tell this, so she has, as Roberta Gregory draws her really like her, she has on one side the speaking balloon, and on the other side the singing balloon, you know, so and this goes down as they're oppositional. So Roberta is sometimes really, there's a confusion sometimes, she gets addressed by her fans sometimes as if Bitchy Bitch is her person. So she is really also trying to, as she comes out of it, what happened in comics can be, I think, late 70s, early 80s, that they start to become a bit autobiographical. And not that it's really biography of the author, it's more that they mix that kind of ideas with reality. As it's like really, as it became very, very interesting in some shapes and also a bit more open to women, as even though the comic scene was very male dominated. But at this time, the 80s came really fantastic female characters out of the comic industry, like Roberta Gregory, for example. And I think the founder of this autobiographical issue was actually Robert Crumb. And I show here as a Sherry Flanagan, for example, from the 60s. She was part of the Air Force. And she was interesting because she, when she received, as I showed you, the Spots and Bonnie, which is one of her comics, that she referred to Walt Disney and learned about the cuteness from Disney, but absolutely subversive. So she spoke about sex and violence and whatever, but with the cuteness of Trucks and Bonnie drawings. So this is actually what was the Air Pirates, who got sued by Walt Disney, as their meal was found in Air Pirates, were actually also addressing. And there's another one, Love and Rockets from the 80s, was founded in 1982 by the Hernandez brothers. And this is interesting because how those pages are built up. So there are two brothers, and there are actually three, but only two are doing Love and Rockets. And Jamie and Gilbert. And these are two different, as this is the drawing of Jamie and this is Gilbert Hernandez. And Jamie Hernandez, for example, he met Lucas. Lucas are two teenage girls met in Brooklyn. And they're like Latin, as their dress kind of is like Latin American living in the USA. And Gilbert Hernandez, for example, he produced Paloma, which is a little village, fictional village, somewhere in Latin America. And his main character is Nuka, a woman. And what happens, how they build up the magazine of the market is that on the one as a some pages are drawn by Jamie with Lucas, and then suddenly Gilbert shows up, and they switch, in some issues they switch characters, so the characters are walking, crossing boundaries, and crossing different worlds. So this is kind of interesting what the comic allows in terms of space. I mean, there is this kind of space which is called drama. So we have panel drawings, and the in-between blank space is drama. And this is in the syntax, everything very interesting because it's based on the thinking, how you switch from one image to the next and what happens in language and in literature. And this is often used by comic writers as the kind of off space when nothing happens, but there happens more than you as a reader. You build everything here together. That is a space which is created by comic artists, which I find very interesting in terms of for the class here, it's like working with the team at the moment. Yeah, and I want to show you some sequences of comic artists. Brian? One second. So this is now Air Pirates, back when he is in the 60s, as he founded it in the 60s. This is out of the DDT called Comic Books Confidential by one man. Very good documentation about comic artists in the 80s. And I think it was shot in 1987.
some sort of bizarre concept to steal the air, pirate the air, steal the media. It was time, at that time, you know, we were here. How it was impossible for one person to stem the conservative tide. So five of us thought we were, and that's what it takes, you know, one person, but not too many more. As you can see, all the ugly creeping in. And Nixon's second. By 68, you know, being elected by 70 was bad. So the thing was, let's attack a corporation. You know, everybody should attack a corporation that their own. And so, since we were cartoonists, the net logical thing was Disney. Yeah, this is where the trouble started here. This is really Mickey Mouse. And that's when we signed our names. The plot was, this was very dissolute, Hollywood started. And an affair was produced, two nephews, so-called nephews. And so they were kidnapped by their nephews and by all their old hired. The nephews had hired the old villains to kidnap mom and dad, get them to the island, and get them loaded, and get them and give them a cowboy bill of production, and make them marry each other so the kids would not be nephews anymore, so they'd be the legitimate son and daughter of Mickey Mouse. Yeah. So I think what it was when they started having sex in the jail hole, and the nerd was in jail cell, and that kind of really got them going. You couldn't criticize him because if you drew a mouse, it didn't look like what, you know, the so-called parody version. The parody had been weakened to the point where it loses its shock. If I want to draw Ronald Reagan, I'm forced to draw somebody that looks like something else, and then it's not him. So nobody gets the joke. Who's that guy that almost looks like somebody I know and what's his name? The joke just goes against it. Parody means, to me, that you get the exact image and you turn it inside out, 100%. 180 degrees, you turn it inside out. Why? That's what I did. Because anybody with half a brain knows that Mickey Mouse wouldn't do this until, of course, we went farther than we're supposed to. This is a real Mickey Mouse. Because they said so right away in court, they busted us. They said, charge me $1,200,000. I said, that's a real Mickey Mouse. I said, it was a parody. They said, no, it's real. I said, no, it's a parody. They said, no, it's real. Okay, bust me. So they did. Bang, $1,200,000. So 10, 13 years, we're sitting in the court. We get. It just takes these old guys a long time. Don't ever put your fortunes in the hands of the law. They take forever. I actually have tape recordings of the Seventh Circuit, the Ninth Circuit of Appeals, to sound asleep during my trial. The whole thing, you know. And so, customs. Well, we fought back. That meeting was the president. Because we started off with a hopeless condition and see what we can do with that. I mean, as long as it's hopeless, why not? If you're going down in flames, hit something big.
Women in overground comics, they were there, but they were not appreciated. They were doing things like color work, and they were doing the work, but they were not known. And the romance comics were almost all done by men from a male perspective, done for women, but were not really representing a woman's viewpoint. My work apparently, it's like it projects an image. It must project an image of such innocence. Apparently the style is so innocent that people, they don't see it. It's in front of their eyes and they don't see it. And that's why I've been able to talk about some really, you know, extreme subjects, because the work itself is so accessible and kind of, people call it naive. And so it was always, a lot of people at first said, oh, well, this looks like children's books. And said, why don't you do children's books, which like pays miserably, and like, of course, I mean, what, how can I talk about things that I want to talk, how can I talk about sex in a children's book? And that's what I wanted to talk about. That and political things. A children's book about capital punishment, right?
The defendant, Elrod Stellman, stands accused of the kidnapping and rape of Mrs. Ingalls' Kitty Beulah. How does the little menace to society plead? He's obviously guilty. I found his footprints in the litter box. plus Beulah's flea collar was in his baseball card collection. Due to this indisputable evidence, I find Elrod a threat to the tranquility of this neighborhood, and I'm really grossed out. You're dead, Elrod. I'm sure glad this toaster has a lot of execution for me. Oh, Elrod, I'm sorry. I don't think he'll ever do it again. Who do you think you are, Fry? We can't pardon him. Smells like soup.
It's hard to keep the crime rate in your electric bill down at the same time.
I think at this moment I should also state here that whenever I produce this magazine, I do have a team.
So I never worked with the CFT team on a next issue, and this has the reason is that I don't want to be around Asia to repeat myself. So a new team always is challenging me also, and getting a new point of view up to the extent. Also, I want those to that new characters are coming, also in the layout. So the graphic team is very important for me because that the beginner magazine looks in the layout always kind of different with the graphic team. Even though I make the whole package, the story boards. But then I sit with them, we're constantly on it, and I want to see that it is their part of it, they're not just the operators. In 2000, I was producing the fourth issue, and this now is Sweden, it was the Modena Hussein project. And here I was focusing on her stories instead of his story. And I thought I just showed here the VW as an example. As I came up with this title, and for the interview I did with Martin Hancock. Martin Hancock is a soap writer, and he wrote for a soap which we have in Germany. As we bought it from Australia, and the Swedes bought it from Germany. So, and he's one of those kind of storyline writers. And so he speaks about, in this interview, we speak about what it means. Writing soaps in terms of responsibility towards society, and on the other hand, in terms of how much certain characters in the society adopt something such a soap character. So it was, became a bit fictional, as it was really the walking line between documentation and fiction. And then he was writing from a magazine, a soap in three episodes, where the magazine, Regina, is the main character. So he was writing those kind of lines down. He was also published in the magazine. And the layout is here a bit like how you would write episodes and deliver it to the outer, how the outline writer delivers to the storyline writer and the storyline writer delivers it to the characters. At the same year, 2000, I produced also the fifth issue, and this was this time for a women in university, which was a pilot project happening in Germany, in Hannover, it took place. And so I was asked if I would produce a magazine about this university, about the subjects, all the subjects which were raised during this 5 months the university was happening. And so this was the first time actually where I was not so free from creating my own subject, because it was pretty much focusing just on the subject this university was raising. It was, for example, body, work, information, and water. And you see here a concentrated where I chunked it out of those kind of chapters which I usually have. I have also in the beginner magazine those chapters, fashion, partnership, recipe, gardening. And here's the first time where I created new chapters, even though I had similar subjects. And for example, here is chapter wet, where I was speaking then also about, you can see it here, this was actually where I was speaking about trafficking in the interview. And on the right side, you see what is the back cover of this magazine, it's a work of mine called Renovation. And this is more, has had more to do about what also these women, the abbreviation of this women university, IFU. They meanwhile changed to WIT, WIT, Syrian Institute of Technology, Development and Culture. And renovation I put as a back cover to actually as a symbol, as a reference also, how what we have to renovate from kind of traditional academies or universities. So like you start from a university, so what could we do? And it is showing, was actually also an exhibition in 2000, which I did in Prague, in Montpellier. And it was all laid out with moving cardboard boxes, which you usually move in your households. And the whole space, as I wanted to get away, the ones and all from the white cube discussion. So I was like, you know, you always move those on the line, and actually we speak about our surroundings also. And every wall is something in written, something still the stretching of the walls, and what you see here is that this also on this page before. This is that wallpaper. So either come down or you put down. So it's like a pictogram of wallpapers. And you see that here also the wall painting. And in the very back is actually also one of those moving cardboard boxes. And it is laid out like a ground floor plan for the living room. So in 2002 came out the number 6 of Regina, and this time it was again produced in Germany, and it was focused on the industrial area in Germany, the Ruhrpott, so which is the coal mining industry, and it's actually this time in Germany, other things always changes. And those people who live there are constantly are confronted with changes and certain suffering high up in the economy. And I was calling it still life. And still life really actually also in, I was looking for allegories. And allegories like which were hidden, but people told me, telling stories. And also still live, and it's usually a man of terminology coming from the Dutch company. And it's like somehow something still is moving, something still alive, and still it was dead. So it's a constant. And it has a whole rich history, which is far too wide on the book. Deliver a very high student in art history, so what it really means, what it stands for. And to just show it in regard to space, also, I was here interviewing two techers who pretty known as techers in Berlin, actually, but techers are all over the world, so they also have been working in the industrial and the world part. And so this is an interview about open communication. So how the 15 as a microcosm of society works or doesn't work. So they were sticking out. Not allowed to tell you their names. So here you see actually one globe which I did also discussion for the issue, which is made out of what's called home tool. And in ordinary it's kitchen house, but actually its origin comes from the Münsterland, and it was woven in big sheets to give to the coal mines that are drying the whole body, because it absorbed a lot of the dust of the coals. So they haven't had to clean so often, so they didn't look so easy dirty, so it has its name Kuku Tool, and hardly anybody knows about the origin. People use it only as kitchen house now. And it was woven on a shahar knitting. And so I designed this kind of clothes for this issue. And it's called Still Life. So the techers I interviewed, they're just tacking in the bag that still in mind. So it's a coat and a dress, which I produce under my name in Brown and Berlin. This is so far number 7, it's produced in Norway, which is so far. And this one, I had first time no dyed structure. I was just working with symbols, and it was a mix of the stellulose. Stellulose is the pattern of the region in the US, and of a gothic metal pattern. So working with stands on a mixture, you see on the right hand side already what we came up with, a mixture between cellulose and Gothic patterns, circles like music at certain depth. And here you see how it is broken together in the left state for it. You see a silver again, which shows like this kind of five issues, so the silver was also worth of time. And I think I should say that the Regina magazine has a limited background, so it's not really working as a magazine, it's not a catalog, and it's not really a women fashion magazine. So again, you can't categorize it here. And I was actually happy when I saw it in bookstores, as mostly bookstores have it, routine with architecture, art, design, as a matter of certain focus. And those bookstores don't different shops. Sometimes you find it under my name, chronologically. Sometimes you find it under fashion design. Sometimes you find it under art magazines. So they themselves always place it however they think they deal with it. And I have to say, I was happy about this to see that. So it was not just in one place, but each, everybody refers to it. And I myself, I can't help with this. I mean, I produce it. But it does serve my function as a women fashion magazine on the market. And it is also, it is not a fancy flash. It is not a mimicry. It is a model. And so I never tried to mimic a fancy flash from a fashion magazine. I really was trying to produce a model, how it could be done also, and how you can write. So here comes the writing style. I have so many different writing styles included in the magazine. I ask sometimes authors, I come up with a subject, and I edit it. And I'm in close contact with them. So I have a long time to produce it. Mostly I work 6 months on it. And this is what a normal magazine in the market can't do. This time I don't have. I have really time to make deep research and to communicate with the authors, so with my interview partners, so it can go back and forth in long periods of time. As it's really deeply shaped them. And I work very close also with the graphic designers and with the photographers. As I have also sometimes a photographic team for the cover always. For the cover, I work always with fashion photographers. And then it's also spoken about looking at competitively how the style is. And we do this shootings, for example, mostly in the last step, because then I know immediately the content, I know the content, and the cover is actually the door as if you walk into the magazine. So now I'll show you here a bit another space of territory space. This is my work called Country. And I worked here with an architect and trainer and with an industrial designer on the construction. And this country comes in five elements. It's produced after a knock-down principle, which is a sophisticated option to include yourself. So it's everything is lighted in. There's no smooth, no nothing. It's like you can take it very easily apart. And then it can come out of itself. And this country is actually part of my native embodiment. Embodiment, as I use always refer also to my own body size measurements. So this country is 165 in height. And it can be really used for cats, so we try to step it. The cat can really jump all up and can deconstruct it. And you can use it also as a weird furniture, whatever. I mean, so you. And this is my cat Dorian. So she was a test person, actually. So she always had to jump, so we have to see if the cat has static. I'm not sure because she can't do it. And this here is actually the logo from embodiment. So this logo was actually very long to design, also the steel communication. And there's a little E inside, and you see. And what it is in the end is like we took two pictograms of sewing stitches, you know, sewing machines, and they have those pictograms, what kind of stitches you can use. So there's a two of them mixed as a the outer part of two of them, and then the inner one is one, so which we mix. And at the same time, I wanted also to give it a bit of the feeling of a brown floor then. So what I do with embodiment, I work with clothing. And I'm not sure if it works in English so good, but in German it's called Bekleidung. And this means that you cover, but not just your body, but also the interior. So I took on this kind of women roles. We are like kind of working with interior, we're working with clothes, we're working with fashion. So kind of this kind of roles mostly is addressed, was addressed to this kind of stereotypes. And I took this on this embodiment, so it was, but I'm doing a stretch of those kind of boundaries, but I produce those kind of models. I always produce prototypes, which you can only order in limited editions, maximum is 3. And it is always on the body measure of the collector or purchaser. And it has a narrative, so I've got mostly the narrative line. And also those embodiment productions have inherited narrative to the anecdotal functionality or where, and we also try to judge this art and functionality. So all those productions are doing the body of function, the function as a furniture, the function as a clothes, but they're also something else, so it's like the speaker for something else. And then I want to show that the narrative back to comics, back when everybody knows, I'm not sure if everybody knows personality. Kind of character inside Batman. So she was always a character for me, and Batman's fighting her. And actually, she's always put in this Batman story as like an evil character. And I think she's fantastic, she's not evil at all. I mean, what she tries to do, she tries to protect the environment. And she gets also like mad and very killing, killing Ivy. Then the environment gets destroyed, the human beings. So when they enter her space and destroy the plants around her. So I think I'm going to show which I did in the Institution in 2004, as he is also practiced as a catalog, as we also do. So I picked her as my starting point, but I did not narrate my story according to Catherine how she is. So I split her as two characters. I split her into Poison and Ivy. So this is Poison, for example. This is a Institution, which is, I did two dioramas which align across each other. So this is one with the other, and they're directly across from each other. And so this one is Poison, the body man, and there's next to it is an empty box, and across from her is Ivy. And this is also from a body man born dress design. The whole exhibition was called Embodiment Dress Plot. And dress plot comes from the film industry. Because in the 20s, when we had designing in the area, we hadn't had costume designs yet. So what they did, the actors, actresses and actors, they were responsible for their own clothing. And some actresses were starting to sew really brilliant clothes that were this kind of diva types also. And so what the guy that did the dress without the body had suddenly be able to tell the story, the sequences of the film. So they laid it out in this called dress plot. So it picked up on this kind of moments. What happens when the body is gone? And in the fashion industry, for example, the body never, as now they start with the discourse, like Elizabeth Wilson is one of the highlights, and who's always addressing the body. But slowly there comes the discourse about fashion and body, clothing and body again. But, I was here now looking also what happens when the body is gone. So all my characters speak now in this kind of exhibition through their clothes and through voices, which I actually, this is important for the inner magazine also, I created a space, a platform for voices which are usually not heard. So it's not that I interviewed necessarily famous people, but I have also known people inside the magazine. So there's a mixture of giving a good context and platform for people, which I find also interesting now to address, which the magazine sometimes does not do, as a little bit not too much. And so here, I was creating also a radio play. This two actresses were speaking Poison, the one was speaking Poison, the other one was speaking Ivy, and I wrote the radio play down, which were addressing, Poison was addressing that she's fighting with her costumes. Her costumes are enemy, and her costume was referring to the microcosm as an actually macrocosm society. So the society is putting pressure on her, it's her costume, this is like a step. So she's talking this direction, while Ivy is talking about her plants. So she's like this kind of woman who's taking care of the plants, and it's based on both texts of collages. There's my person, and it's text collages also with small from the 19th century, do you know this small? So against nature, yeah. So against nature is one of the references, and so it's very condensed. And unfortunately, it is in German language only. It doesn't make sense to record it to you. And how we did it was that the actors were sound recorded as if they are on the theater stage. So you hear always like footfalls. You hear certain kind of sounds. And this radio play is running actually in this room. And this room is laid out as like a catwalk. water from a shirt, which is Ali. And I thought to this, it was hard to photograph and to talk about that. This is actually a theater curtain. It could be a living curtain, but can also be a theater curtain. And this curtain was hanging in the next room from the little setting here in Bodiman Cluster. And this referred, and on the walls around, was like a text board, as if in a movie, where all the credits of all the people who were involved were using this thing. And this curtain, I referred to because Poise and I are talking as separate people, and you need to take a while to be realizing they talk together or not, and I don't tell you now, because I mean, I hope your translation comes out at one point. But I have a find, they do find each other as one person again, so they start to become Poise and I. And then the curtain shuts down, or the curtain opens. So what I was doing in the end is like, I bring the next deal with the Poise and I. That is actually what I want to do. So that was the show for the press book. And since we are now in the interior, this is from 1993, a work. It was in the Liverpool Cathedral in Unity in Germany, so he has three, he built three unities, as you probably know, like Marseille, Berlin, and Germany. But Germany is the only one, was at this time the only one here which was social housing. And what happened was that they closed down the north part of the building, and it was like a ghost town. And when you it was the north or the south part, I'm not sure now. But when you went through the elevators from the part which the people were living in and went out, you could see through glass. They didn't put bricks up, you could see glass, they couldn't enter the floor, and you saw all those kind of long rows emptied out, hallways. So it was a very political issue at this time, and what would happen to this building? This building were living architects. And not the foreigners who had not a high income. And it was built on the hill after the hill was moved down. And what happened was that he was the curator of this exhibition. He invited artists, architects, designers, and what I thought was really important to him, he invited also people from the building to live there and to create the show. And it was about this unity. And so what happened, we were then, as with our work, we could choose from this empty space, from this empty left apartments, we could choose to use with what we would want to work with. And I decided to work with the kindergarten, which was still at this time working on the top. It was like heaven. And people could see it as the significance, science, this building was actually vibrating. The blackboard sliding board, yeah? As you can see here, the blackboard. And he divided in the kindergarten, in children rooms. Each children was divided into such a sliding board, so we worked on it, and when we opened it, we were next to it. And so he said also, the kindergarten is the extension of the home. This was his sentence towards this building. And actually, when we went in up to the kindergarten, it was all full, so sliding doors also. And it was really for children happy to be there, because they had two floors, and there were ramps, and they had a garden up on the top roof. So it was for the 60s, also great to see that also for the kindergarten was working for all the people who lived there. This means you as a mother or father, you could bring your child up to the kindergarten. Yeah, and then you leave and work. And so this was actually for this time really an advantage. And so I was thinking I worked with the kindergarten. So I worked with the kindergarten, and what I did, I was asking the architect. watched those kids with me, and it was immediately water. I mean, they couldn't deal with the water in between. They were like, and it was interesting how they said, rebuild their own group. And this was actually what I tried to talk about. I tried to talk about the generation conflict. And also what buildings are catching for us. So actually, I think sometimes you can watch children or teenagers where they hide where they're doing the building. And this might be maybe the best part of it, because they see space, they see room for something. They're not always watched. And so I was like trying to build up here a narrative line, which is so I am maybe should give this. Sorry, but yeah, what you see here, the very first one, you see the man, we had the other three mothers, and I had dolls in different scales, which are asked by all over the world, every embassy, to send in the traditional doll, what they have in the traditional doll. So we put them all in this first room, which was the room where actually kids could play, or also adults could walk in. Play with the whole architecture. The second room was then the kindergarten, was the kids did as a display, and here you could already start not to touch really anymore. And then came the coloring book, I did a coloring book with them also, which was all about scale, how you speak within a certain scale. And the last room is actually where the mod, as well as the doll's house. This was the last room. Where it was protected, as if the doll's house was protected by the orange one. And this was actually the other room. Suddenly, so kids manipulate. So they kids don't manipulate. As soon as they get, they don't manipulate. Because when you don't manipulate as much, you need anymore as children. So that was certainly those kind of values. And then I come now to the last point, which is the play sculpture, which was then the topic where I did also for kindergarten again. And this was a moving box. And so I tried to design like a moving box. And so I was asked to do a project, to come up with a project for the kindergarten. You see it here on the right hand side is the kindergarten. And it's near Vienna, in Großmünde. It's a little village with 600 inhabitants. And it's really like on the countryside, the kids have really the countryside. But you go to children, and I saw that they had no playground at all afterwards, nothing. Because, I mean, of course, there were fields, but during the day, they have to be there also, I mean, the teacher has to watch out for them, they can't run through the fields. So I decided I would construct a playground for them, and then they came out as a visitor. And it was designed out of children drawings. So they got the question that you prefer to play outside and so forth. And then I got all the children drawings. And I was collaging them together to a weird construction. And then I gave it to a constructionist who then was designing these lines and how it would line up. And we put a big moving box up with it. So on top of it, because Haida was at this time selected as this kind of marketing person. So I made kind of a human chain. And what you don't see on the other side, you see also the word children group. So this moving box is when you move the item, and we meet in Sherman or Jewish, we have this, that you always cross which kind of toys or items are inside the box. Is it from your living room, from your bedroom, from your kitchen, or in this case it was the children rooms. And I gave it all those different languages, all languages from people who live in Austria. That was the public art project, and then there was one which I showed you the tape. It is called Question Mark Section, which Schutzmann about created. Then in 1996, it was in the Louisiana Museum in Denmark. And it was, the show was called Now Here. And at this time, Lars Lippe was the director, and he did the first time he rented out the Louisiana Museum from its collection. So he opened it up to contemporary art and he invited five curators, international curators, to work with contemporary art. And all this under Now Here, but each curator named it in a different section again. And so put it was running circulator, we wrote together this magnetic line on it, and it was called the question mark section. And I show you now a tape which I directed with the question mark theme mark character actually. So we, because Louisiana, what you should know, the Louisiana Museum has a sculpture park and directed on its theme. And it's really beautiful. And lots of people travel there on the weekends. Not necessarily to see art, but really have a picnic. And, but at the same time, they learn something about art because it's really so nicely and educationally as a, not like that to create like an alone sense built up, it's that it can reach various levels and meanings in this kind of museum. And it was so great that to see how public art, as in this kind of sculpture art, is kind of what people also use, and how they deal with it and surround it. So what we did on the day of the opening of Now Here, I was shooting this video. We had to be very quick because we needed public. And, but at the same time, this video was also then screened on the entrance of the question mark section, so where the whole curatorial exhibition was happening, so it was broken down. And this is now what I'm going to show you the talk today. And if you have questions, here, question mark afterwards, please. Is the other committee?
Yeah.
Very high volume music. Which is, I have to say it's bad quality because we were shooting it in high 80 this time. So it got transformed so many times that colors, I like the colors that you mean, but it's very off. Thank you.